Yes, so Christoph Barbeck is going to present a talk about big data strategies for automated high throughput research lines. So Christoph, when you are ready, you can start sharing your screen.
Yeah, thank you. So my pleasure to be here to present, and thank you for the kind invitation to present here. Perfect. Just let me clean up the screen. So good morning again. My name is Christoph Drabitz. I'm working at the Friedrich Alexander University at the Department of Material Science. And I'm also affiliated with the Research Center Jülich, FZJ. And I'm a director at the High Aaron for high throughput methods. For today, I would like to quickly introduce you in the research facility. Automated research we have built in Erlangen over several institutions. And then I will go to the long-term challenge we are working on, and this is automated, autonomous and automated research infrastructures. Just briefly, lots of the focus we are working in is on photovoltaics. We do have an effort on the material science, which is coming from the FAU, so lots of the material and device development is done there. There is a cooperation with the Energy Campus Nuremberg, where we are operating a process line, and at the Helmholtz Institute Erlangen-Nuremberg, we are going all the way towards the system with the high throughput methods. To give you an example on how this looks like, at the High Aaron and together with the FAU, we are developing a platform which we called Amanda, which is for autonomous and accelerated material and device development. And that will be the focus for today, to introduce a little bit on this Amanda and the concept behind Amanda on doing accelerating material and device development. Right now it's automated, and in the future we hope to go autonomous. We are planning to do the same on piloting, so we don't think that we should stop automation of research at the lab. We believe the benefit even will be higher if we can do this at a pilot level. So this is what we will attack in the next couple of years, to introduce automated research on real production or pilot equipment, which is even more challenging than to do this in the lab. The focus we have behind is on the lifetime and sustainability testing. So whatever is coming from Amanda to the lab here then should go into lifetime testing, so that we are coming closer to the system's requirement and we can go to full system and demonstration systems. So the last two points will not be stressed for today. That is what I'm going to discuss, and I will give you an introduction on this Amanda line. So it's nothing else than the lab with a high level of automation. We have about 80 to 90 separate tools we are controlling, and I'll introduce in more detail the philosophy and the concepts behind. And please keep in mind, we are not at the stage, but what we would like to do in the future is to introduce the same logics, the same research logics and data quality to piloting lines, so that we can do the R&D level on process relevant equipment. So the overall objective and the philosophy we are following, the traditional approach, the way we are doing research and how our PhDs are doing research is the manual approach. So this means there's a hypothesis, there is a material, there is a process. We combine the hypothesis with the material. We characterize it. We have the evaluation from the raw data to the evaluated data, and then we verify the hypothesis. The first step we are planning now with the automated platforms is that there is the researcher, he has an hypothesis and he wants to verify it on an automated platform. And again, we go through the same loop, precursor processing characterization. And the researcher still would do the evaluation and verifying the data quality. When we go to this autonomous platforms or closed group research platforms, then we imagine that we have an automated platform which is capable of doing such a development cycle, and it can do this automated without any input from the outside. But the question is, from where do we get the hypothesis and the evaluation? And these would be the AI agents, which are now starting to formulate a hypothesis and then retrieve back the data, do the evaluation, and then the conclusion. So by linking these two together, this would be a disclosed loop and the first step towards autonomous. We still will have, besides the way the AI is working, the database and evaluation, there will be the researcher, and the task of the researcher will be to pose the relevant questions and to understand the value of the outcome. So in all of these aspects, we will have the active role of the researcher, but depending on whether we are on the manual process, to the automated, to the closed loop, the role of the researcher will evolve and develop on a different level. So these are the researchers. I'm speaking mainly from today. The development of line one is headed by Jens Hauch and Christian, Jared, and Stefan, you can see here, contributed tremendously in developing this. So this was a bottom-up development, which means that even the software, the controls, routines, the agents, the APIs, all were written by this team. On the material evaluation, that is headed by Thomas. And I'm going a lot on the data. He and Chayan Chao and Rong developed together with Jonas on the organic solar cells and the head behind the development of the models. And the ML and AI algorithm is Larry. And that is what I'm referring for today. Let me also acknowledge funding from different projects. And I want to highlight that part of the work we're doing is under the Fermat proposal for VR in the research area E for the optoelectronics. So this also explains why today I'm speaking a lot about optoelectronic devices and characterizations. One of the material systems which is fascinating for us for quite a while actually is this organic photovoltaics. It's a highly active researched field. There are efficiency records probably every other month. There are lifetime records, but it's still in the research. It's not really on the market. And the idea is what is missing to get such a very promising technology. What do we miss to get this on the market, and can we accelerate this? Let me briefly introduce you to the organic photovoltaics. The first papers came out in 1995. From the Santa Barbara group, from Alan Heger. And the very important observation, which was done even a little earlier by Serda Sarachivci and Alan Heger, was that when you add fullerene to a pi-conjugated semiconductor, you can get a very fast charge transfer. Now, for anyone working in semiconductors, you would say this is not surprising. It is surprising for the organics because the pi conjugated systems are excitonic, and exciton binding energy in the order of maybe a few hundred millielectron volt. So the free charge generation rate in a pristine material is below 0.1%. Now, when you mix two semiconductors with preferential potential differences, you can get a charge transfer which has a quantum efficiency of up to 100%. And we could verify why this is the case, and the case is you see in the transient pump probe spectra. This is the case because it's really fast. So you can see here, this is the trace where the CT is kicking in, and it's happening at a time delay of some tens of femtoseconds. So it's very fast, and this is the reason why it is so efficient. Now, this we can regard as a molecular diode. Now, a molecular diode is a great piece for a solar cell, but you have to imagine a solar cell is a macroscopic device. So this means you have to understand how to arrange and how to order and how to distribute these molecular diodes in a pipe. And that was for quite a while, it was not understood that the most homogeneous mixing is actually a disadvantage, because the more you mix these two systems, the more you have recombination and losses. And only when you start to get a phase separation between the systems, and this was pioneered by Jean Chardin almost 20 years ago. Only if you get this phase separation, which you can see here also by the AFM images, then you create domains, and these domains may have a purity, and the purity and the size of the domains is actually determining the performance. So this is the complexity of the system we are talking about. We have a phase A, which is an acceptor, and we may have a phase B, which is here the donor phase. Light is coming in, we excite light, and it's an exciton. It's not a free carry. This exciton can diffuse to the interface, and here at this line of the interface between these two domains, we will get the splitting of the charge. You have then the positive carriers, and afterwards the transport, the electronic transport will happen in the respective phases, the electrons and the holes here. So you see that we have a very complex microstructure far away from what we are used on crystalline semiconductors. We have disordered systems with domain sizes within the excellent diffusion lengths, which are a few nanometers to a few tens of nanometers. And we really have to control them. Like 1 nanometer domain size, no performance, 100 nanometer domain size, again, no performance. So we have to be able to influence that. That is the reason why organics have been developing a little slow, I would say. There was a slow trace in the beginning. And most recently, we have seen a strong development going up here, thanks to a new class of materials. And by today, the efficiencies are in the order of 20%. You can see here still a little less than the inorganic solar cells, but 20% is the benchmark for where you would think that a solar technology may get a chance on the market. So why we are not on the market with the solar cells is that you can look at the NREL table here with these performance, it's record efficiency cells, which are typically fairly small. And a product is a module, not a single solar cell, which is should be fairly large. And you can see between the cells and the modules, there's just a little bit of a drop. But when it goes to an industrial product, then there's significant drop. And if you are asking us where we should start with the acceleration of a material science, then it's not so much in this regime, but it's probably more in this regime. And this explains why Amanda, I'm introducing today, this is working here in that regime. But the pilot line I was showing you in the second slides in the beginning, this would be working in this regime. And actually, we think that acceleration at the higher tier level is even more beneficial. But we are not at the stage there. So let me show you one of the state-of-the-art systems, which I take as a proxy to introduce in our automation and data strategy. That was great work by Feng Liu and Ming Zhang, and they were taking 4 materials, 2 P-type semiconductors, 2 N-type semiconductors. So they had a quaternary blend, and they could show indeed by finding the right ratios of mixing and the right processing conditions, they could get an improved performance from 14 to almost 18%. And they also saw slightly better stability, not tremendous better stability. Red is the original, blue is that quaternary, but at least from the trend, it looked a little more stable. So that means that the material science now has to deal at least with quaternary systems. So let me make a break here and explain you the complexity of quaternary systems for materials invention. The time it takes a new material from the early stages to the market, actually, the way we understand it is slowing down compared to silicon. And we can discuss what silicon, the invention of silicon was, probably the disseminal paper from the Bell Labs in 1954. It's about 25 years until this technology was on the megawatt level. Right, and we would now by today, a megawatt level is not a lot. The pilot line I showed you in our labs has a megawatt level. Silicon is not the only one. If you go to optoelectronics, gallium nitride, it's not so different. Let's suggest that 1972 was the first demonstration of electroluminescence and gallium nitride. It was discussed before that quite a while. And the first bright LEDs on the market were between 93 and 94. So we might think about 20, 22, 24, 26 years again. So that's the time it takes. And if you analyze why it's so complicated from a new material on a new material composite towards a finalized product, you have to imagine that in the early stages, the way we do material research is sequential. In the early stages, we have material innovation. Then we go to the device. Then we go to a process optimization. Then we go to lifetime. Then we go to scale up. And if you fail at any of the stages, like in the process optimization or in the lifetime optimization, you have to go back to the beginning. Now, that's for a single material. If you now take ternary, quaternary, quaternary plans, if either of those materials is failing, you have to go back. So you understand the complexity. What we are missing is we need a predictive model which can take a molecular motive or a chemical structure. And we need predictive models which can translate a motive into a product property. In the case of solar cells, this would be the cost, the lifetime, the efficiency. So that is the challenge we are after. Coming back to the quaternary systems, how complicated can that be? So let's assume just this four quaternary, the quaternary systems with four semiconductors I mentioned before. If you mix them in a 10 weight percent regimes, you're getting 1,000 composites. That's just the composite. If you take into account the process, the different solvents, the annealing, the concentration ratios, the film, thin film coating procedures, and you just assume like 100 variations for each composite, we have 100,000 layers. Now, that's not a solar cell. If you go to the solar cell, we need the interfaces, we need the electrode, we need the charge extraction layers. Again, just 100 variations for one of these layers, and we added 10 million devices. 10 million devices is beyond what we could do by human operation. And actually, it's also beyond what we can do by robot operation. So this means that the high throughput concept I'm proposing will not be enough in order to manage the full optimization of such complex systems. What we need would be something which can abbreviate here from the material to the final product. And we would like to do this with a couple of thousand experiments, which can be done in a day, in a days, rather than a 10 million experiments. So this is the way we assigned Amanda. So what is Amanda? Amanda is a set of hardware, like spin coder, hot plates, transport robots, evaporators, so everything which you have in the lab, and it's integrated in the Glovebox system. Amanda is controlled by software. Mainly it's a scheduling robot, which is deciding on the sequence of running a process. The software is controlling the hardware. There's also an interface to a database you will see, and all the input from our sensors and remote access will go into the control. We have an interface for computation, which is then the reach out to the machine learning agents, which you need later. So the user itself right now can interact over a graphical user interface where we have the planning and the analysis, or we see the analysis, and what we decide on the graphical user interface is going into a control. And all the data we get from here and all the data we get from here over in here is going into a database and will be made accessible by APIs. So this is kind of the sketch we have on the database and the way we extract it currently. Amanda, the line one is not finished. So we are very flexible here in adding further tools we are developing together with companies like spin coding robots. And there will be a family of these hardware platforms which you can integrate and then use very versatile in anything which is about thin film processing, multi-layer processing, and device, optoelectronic device engineering. So that is what Amanda is doing. And on an image from the lab, it's a simpler step. We have the glove boxes. I'll introduce you the sequences on the glove boxes in a second. We have metallization, we have the control desk, and all we need in order to fully optimize the device is in this one lab under inert atmosphere. In the detail, if you go to the first box, which is the solution preparation, What we have there are pipetting robots. The pipetting robots just are doing mixing, they prepare stock solutions, they can do the weighing of powders, they can do shaking, they have a quality control on the stability of the solutions. Everything we do in solutions in the solvent atmosphere is done here. After that, there's a SCARA robot, which is transferring the solutions from here into the box two. In the box two, what we are doing is we can dilute the solutions, the master solutions, the stock solutions into the final ready-to-go spin coating solutions. We can do the spin coating of the layers. I'll show you in a second how we do this. If I switch this off, we can do the spin coating of the layers. We can do a post-treatment. We have all the quality control there by optical spectroscopy, by photos. We can do thermal annealing. So all what you otherwise would do in the lab, and after we are finished with the spin coating, we have the samples in the box and we move them over here to box three. And in box three, we have all the characterization. We finish the device by metallization. You see here the image of our testing bench where we can do JV measurements in under light, in the dark. We can move the carriers, we can age them, we can post-treat them, and we can characterize them. So that's what we have integrated in Amanda. And the way we store the data, it's an identity and event-based database. So whatever we are generating, whether it's a process, a manipulation, a stock solution, or an image, this is an event. And we start a process with a task for a specific event, which is usually coordinated with a substrate. And whenever we do anything with the substrate, it's getting into an app. And this means we have an event, an ID going into an event. And after this event, we get the metadata, the process data, and this gives a new identity. Okay, and this means in our sequence plan, taking a photo manipulates the ID from one to the next ID. Measuring the absorption, doing the evaporation, whatever it is, this is completely free, always creates a new ID, and in the ID, we are storing all the metadata. And the analysis we are using right now is the image, it's optical spectroscopy, it's the electrical data, JV data, and it's stability data. This is the tool set of data we are currently working together with the process and the metadata. So, let's say the high throughput is the horsepower of our system, but you know that a car is only as good as the assistance system. So let me briefly talk about the assistance systems and the characterization. The challenge we have is the complexity of organic photovoltaics. So for instance, if you take a degradation curve of a cell, which is good in the beginning and which is degraded after 24 hours, usually we have to go for very difficult investigations like electron microscopy, XPS, synchrotron facilities to understand microstructure evolution. And after these weeks of evaluation, we may get an image. So this is not compatible to the way the line one Amanda is working. We need this within minutes and hours, and we need agents in order to extract this information. So we need different ways to do this. The paradigm change we are proposing here is we have to fix the target quantities in solar cells. It would be efficiency, stability, whatever you think is relevant. And you have to clarify the input parameters, which in our case are the materials, the chemical motifs, they can be parameterized, the composition, the processing parameters. Now the challenge is, can we get the link from the processing parameters to the target properties? And usually, no, this link doesn't exist. It's not known, it doesn't exist, we don't understand it. It's just not there. So this is the reason why we usually go over the system properties. So we take the TM, we take the GVEX, we take all these measurements and create this insight into the material properties. And then we hope from these material properties, we can build the relation to the target properties. And this part here is where we lose weeks of investigation. So this doesn't work to an inline system. So we have to skip it. And what we're currently focusing on is we are taking proxy features, and the most prominent proxy we are using currently are optical features. We know that these optical features are attractive because we can collect them fast, but it's not clear whether there's a direct relation or a linear relation or even a non-linear relation between these optical features to the target quantities. If it would be, then this would be a major advantage, because taking an optical spectrum is seconds, and the translation then with the AI agents might be also very fast. So this is the question, can we find such proxies in order to accelerate? The model which is behind these proxies is spectral decomposition. So our semiconductors have a specific absorption. And if you have a blend of semiconductors, we can deconvolute them. You see here material A, material B. And if you are in the optical spectroscopy of soft matters, you will see immediately there are crystalline ordered peaks. There are more amorphous fractions. So this is what we are deconvoluting. You see here the Wapronik evolution of the different spectrum. Overall, we are regarding such an absorption spectrum as a matrix of a basis set, which is the pristine crystalline, the pristine amorphous, the pristine higher order structure times the spectral weight vectors. And if we are able to translate or to fit such a matrix system, or actually to fit the, to invert the matrix of this equation, we can describe the spectrum. So we are getting a parametrics, and there is a lot of physics behind, and we can couple this by evaluating then the fit of the spectrum. For instance, electronic vibrational coupling has a direct causal path to Huygens-Lewis vector. So this is decisive. The order between the short range order in a dispersed system can be analyzed by the spinal relations and has a direct link to the ratio of the ordered and amorphous. The energy of the excitons, the local environment like polarizability, the torsion and twist, these are system properties which are not always direct. So we might get here an endogenous parameter selection, like the polarizability might correlate with the center of the crystalline energy, but also with the absorption strengths. So we have there deconvolution, which we need to do with a multi-experimental parameter fit. Once we would have this, and we have started to do this, we get clear optical models for each of these materials. And by today, we have developed about 30 materials for donor and acceptors, and we have fully established them in an optical model, which is linked to the physical properties. Now, that is the traditional way we would start now to improve a material system. So we understand there are now processing parameters, and the processing parameters might be the concentration, the film formation, the thermal annealing, the treatment. And then in the multiscale modeling, we would go forward with these, and we have a predictive model based on a thermodynamics or a phase field model, which is going to give us insight in the morphology. The morphology like the ordered, the disordered, the domain sizes, the ratio of crystalline to amorphous. We can cross-calibrate with our optical data, and then we take a drift diffusion simulation, and whatever our figure of merit would be, efficiency or cost, we might be able to predict this. So this means that over this optical model, we get from the process material directly to our target property. Still, this requires a lot of the simulation, right? So the final question then is, if we have this high throughput and the agents, the AI agents, which do the spectral modeling and the molecular modeling, they can run the car, but we have to figure out who is the driver. And this is currently what we are working on, and this is the step from highly automated to autonomous. So Amanda is capable of doing UV-Vis, JV data, and it can vary the processing parameter. So on the one hand, we have the spectral agents. We are training so that we get the physical biased information, and together with the JV data, and we can take, for instance, a Gaussian predictive model, and then get a proxy to the target, this figure of merit we have here, which we want to predict. On the other side, Amanda, with getting the JV data, we can directly calculate from the JV data this figure of merit, and then we can go to a Bayesian optimization, and the Bayesian optimizer would start this autonomous loop, which is then optimizing the process properties, and the process properties again would go back to the JV data, or the sample making. So we would get a closed loop here as well for an autonomous optimization. But keep in mind, the major advantage of the spectral agent is that we always will have the physics domain knowledge behind the optimization of the patient. So we always know what the patient would be doing thanks to the optical model. And we have a fair chance at some time that we build the link directly from the process parameters to the optical model back to the patient. So that at some time, we hope we even don't have to make a device, but we can do this optimization with a simple thin film absorption spectrum. Okay, so let me give you a few examples on where we are and why we are using a Bayesian and what are the AI methods we are using. In one of a different group in our institute, these people are doing outdoor electroluminescence measurements from solar modules. And you see here like a movie or images from solar modules. We deconvolute them into single modules. So we go from a movie into single images, we categorize them, we recognize what is a single module. And from this model, we are then training or we are taking a deep learning approach. And we have done this for a few hundred of modules. We had the defect class classification and we could measure the efficiency, and we trained a deep learning model. And at the end, we got extremely good predictive power for these modules. We were limited to cracks because the 600 modules only had as the only defect a crack, as the leading effect a crack. But you see what can be done. Now, these systems of deep learning would be very difficult to translate over to our material systems. It starts with the parameterization of materials, but also from the image recognition, we are not at the stage that we can provide research data as images. We still have rather lists or tables than images. We may change it in some time, but right now it's lists and tables. So this brings me back to why we are using currently the physics-based learning in order to accelerate. And as an example of what is capable of doing by today, I'll show you again this material. This is a donor, a state-of-the-art donor. This is the acceptor. So we have this donor acceptor type bulk heterojunction we are mixing. And on the line one, we made like 120 process variations. We varied the active layer in the donor acceptor ratio, the spin speed, the annealing, the additives. We varied the interfaces here. We varied the layer and interface thickness. This was all what Amanda and line one was doing. We were taking the photographs, the UV-VIS data, TIV, the UV-VIS data. We ran into the spectral deconvolution. We had 12 parameters, and these 12 parameters from the spectral deconvolution, we correlated with these device data here in a Gaussian in order to see whether we can get predictive of the target properties. So this is how it looks like. Here you see a few variations we did, the mixing ratios, the concentration, the annealing temperature, of the ETL. You can see there's sometimes no influence, as you see here, on the active layer spin speed. Sometimes the donor acceptor ratio, there's a clear difference. The ETL, there might be a huge difference. And all of these changes we expect to be mimicked in the absorption spectrum. You can see the evolution of the absorption spectrum. Like here in the spin speed, there's not so much change here, but there's a significant change here, right? So this is going to spectral model we have. And with this, we trained on the efficiency and the fill factor of the solar cell. And I'm just highlighting here the training data on the predicted efficiency versus the measured efficiency. And you can see actually we get a surprisingly good score. The score is almost fantastic if you do this for the VOC, which is describing the potentials of the materials, but also for the efficiency, it's from the first run, it was actually surprising. And in between, we are getting even better relations with more data. Beyond that, we also do understand the prediction. So by target analysis of the critical parameters, we can clearly correlate higher efficiencies with specific material properties, like enhanced crystallinity of the one phase, reduced amorphous regimes of the other phase, the peak position of one of the phases. So we really understand which molecular parameters influencing the overall performance. this is the performance. Even more challenging was the question, will we be able to predict lifetime? So we took these devices and we subjected them to a continuous degradation run under 50 hours of intense light. And then again, we did the same spectral modeling. Now you can see for the single devices, degradation means time zero performance, and it can go down to like 80%, 60% of the performance, depending on the processing conditions. And again, we were taking the optical model, we fitted to a Gaussian progression, and again, you can see we get surprised, in my point of view, surprising good predictive power. Wasn't clear to me that the stability, inherent stability, is information which is hidden behind the optical deconvoluted spectra. Now, you may wonder, is this very specific for just organics, or are these physics-based models? Can we apply them for other systems as well? And we're getting more and more experience. We have translated this to perovskite thin layers, to perovskite cells. We can use it for solubility parameters. We can use it for layer-by-layer processing photovoltaic. So we are collecting more information that this might be, this proxy-based optical parameter analysis might be indeed helpful to bridge from molecular structures to final device performance. Now, at the end, let me also highlight the complexity behind the autonomous optimization. What I showed you before was not autonomous, this was highly automated with AI agents. On the autonomous side, we are currently exploring, and we picked up these quaternary systems from two or three donors and two acceptors in order to find an optimum. I told you before, optimizing a quaternary would require 10 million structures, which we cannot do. So we need more sophisticated parties. So specifically, the question we have been asking here is, what is the most stable quaternary composite against photooxidation? So we took these materials, we put them onto a robot. The robot was making samples. The samples were subject to an UV degradation, and then we take the UV vis data before and after, and the ratio between this was the stability ratio. And we were comparing two approaches. The one was a high throughput approach. Please keep in mind, no process variations, just thin film variations. So this means for a quaternary, we need 1,000 variations at the 10% steps. And in parallel, we took Ambasia and Optimizer to do this autonomous optimization. So for the high throughput experiment, this is how it looks like, 2,000 samples for two different systems of the quaternary were fabricated and tested in less than a week. So this is the power of automation in material science. And if you analyze them, you get a very clear phase diagram. You see here, for instance, high stability, you get the points here, you have a clear regime of destability here. One component was not a good choice, this polymer really reduces the stability. So this is what you immediately see from this high throughput experiment, and you would think with this 1,000 samples, this was doable, and we have the full information and the full understanding behind. In contrast to that, the Bayesian optimizer was using about 40 to 50 variations to find the optimum compositions with the highest stability. You see here the comparison. This is the high throughput screen. All the red dots are data points. And you see the self-driving approach from the autonomous approach from the Bayesian, which was exploring here in the beginning with the blue, but fairly quickly consolidated here at the lowest level and actually even found the most stable composition. So here the autonomous testing, really the autonomous strategy really seems to pay off. As well as in the absolute, the best, the optimum, finding the optimum, but also in the material we used, but the samples per day we could do, the solvents we needed, and the number of experiments it took us in order to find the optimum. It was by a factor of 30 to 40 faster for optimizing the system. So I believe this is very promising as an outlook on how this automation with high throughput and autonomous routines can work together hand in hand in order to accelerate. Now, that was a lot of device discussion. Let me come back to our long-term vision and outlook. And this is work that Chen Chang and Anastasia are currently doing. They are experts in the chemistry and synthetics. And what I've been discussing in this optimization loop was when you start with a material and you optimize the film, you have the closed loop optimization, then the film is optimized, and then you go to the device, you have the closed loop device optimization, then you go to the global product properties, and then you feed this back, and in our case, it would be here because the material is given. Now, how exciting would it be if we can do the same with the material? That we would have a robot which is an agent which is simulating materials. We take physics domain knowledge, reduce the number, then we go to the synthesis of the materials, and then these materials are coming to this stage. Now, if we follow on the structure, the Bayesian optimizer now would give feedback directly on the structure of the materials. This means we could ask questions like, not, can you make the best solar cell out of the material? But we might be able in the future to ask questions, can you synthesize and can you design the best possible material for an application? Now, keep in mind, this is an outlook and we are pretty far away from having any closed loops there. But what we are capable of doing is, thanks to great input from colleagues on material synthesis, we have established an automated process based on microwave reaction for the media library, which has about a million of different structures you can synthesize. And we've picked up the first of them in an automated process. And these materials are wide bandgap semiconductors. We use them as interface materials for perovskites. So we use them here as an HTM for the perovskites. And by today, we have synthesized about an 80 to 100 materials, automated, and sent it further into the device characterization. So we are closing right now the loop in the automation from the synthesis to the device. And if this is working, we hope we will be able to do the same also in an autonomous way. So that's it from my side. I hope I wasn't too much out of time. If there's still time for questions or if there are any questions, I'm very happy to answer them. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. I'm looking around. Is there any question? Yes, Stefan?
In the beginning of your presentation, you showed this long vision with the different roles for the researcher. And what I could not understand, what is the difference between the researcher formulating a hypothesis at the very beginning of the timeline and the researcher formulating a question at the end of your timeline? So what's the difference between hypothesis and question?
Thank you. Yeah, very good point. Hypothesis is the how to do something. And the question would be to define. So a simple question in our case would be, how does the best solar cell look like? Or a question better formulated would be, if you talk to line one, can you make the best possible solar cell? So we would only define the objectives, the long-term targets, and this definition of the targets, it's not trivial. So because you have to break down what does best possible solar cell mean. But in the stage of automated research process, we would ask the question, we would make a pre-formulation of the hypothesis. And this means we either would have to give the materials, define the processes, confine the parameter space, and then ask, how can you make the best possible device within this confined parameter process? Well, assuming that we have an idea on what might be relevant parameters.
Okay, I have one question too. So you excluded, I don't know if it was because you tried that, to go directly from the parameters of the process to the, you know, to some kind of indicator of the performance. Is that because there is not enough data to have some kind of, you know, machine learned model out of that?
I might have been unclear here. Let me verify that. So what we are working on is we want to go from here, this chemical motif, like the structure of the molecule, towards a device parameter. And this would mean we just look at a molecule and you immediately can tell this will have a specific efficiency. Now, there have been great efforts from the Harvard Clean Energy Project trying to do these calculations. The complexity in our system was that the efficiency, it of course is related to the chemical structure, but what is really dominating efficiency is the local microstructure. And by today, we do not have any tools being capable of doing a fast and reliable prediction of a microstructure. Even in the molecular dynamics simulation, it's still difficult. People are doing great jobs there and coming closer. But as long as we have the microstructure of a realistic thin film in between, this is complicating so much. If you would have a single crystal, it would be straightforward. But for disordered systems or mixed crystalline amorphous systems, this is so difficult, and this is the reason why we have to go over these proxy optical features.
Okay, thank you. Questions from the chat? I don't see any. So maybe we can thank Christoph again.